Let's look at another example of using the fzero function to find roots of an equation. In this example that comes from vibrations problems, we are trying to find the value of beta, or all of the values of beta, that satisfy this equality. So the cosine of beta L times the hyperbolic cosine of beta L is equal to negative 1. So we can solve for values of beta that make this true, but we have to put it into the form that f0 is going to be anticipating. Remember, f0 finds zeros of a function, so it's when the left-hand side of our equation is equal to zero on our right-hand side. Currently, the way that this is written, we have something on our left-hand side, something on our right-hand side. We have to make one of the sides equal to zero and then put the rest of that function into f0. So the way I'm going to write my function here, I'm going to call my function y that I'm trying to find the roots of. I'm going to move everything to the left-hand side so that the right-hand side of my equation is now zero. So it's going to be a function just of beta, which I will just call x here. So it's going to be the cosine of x times big L times the hyperbolic cosine, or cosh, of x times big L. And I move the negative 1 to the left-hand side, so I'm going to add 1 to that. So what I'm trying to do is make this expression here equal to 0, and that is what f0 is going to do for me. So if I run this, I'm again using an inline or anonymous function here because it's such a simple function. I'm not going to make a whole M file just for this, but we will make whole M files a little bit later on. All right, so I have my definition for y, and I have to define L, and I have to do that above what I'm using up here. Because, for example, if I try to use this right now, it's not going to let me do that because it doesn't know what L is yet. So before I run this, I have to define L as equal to 1, in this case, 1 meter. So now if I run this, if I put in a value for really what beta is, I get a value here. So in this case, if beta is equal to positive 2, I get negative 0.5656, and that is not equal to 0. Okay, so what I want to do here is find the zeros of this function, or find the, as I wrote it here, the x values that make this expression equal to 0. Now I can plot this. I don't know necessarily where these zeros are going to be, and finding this analytically would be very, very difficult to do. It's not like a polynomial where I can just find the roots of it fairly easily. Here there's going to be an infinite number of roots, I don't know where they are, and they're not going to be at regular intervals either. So if we look at a plot of what this function is going to look like, if we try to kind of eyeball where the zeros are of the function, and I only want positive values of beta, or in this case x, let me just go to 25 and see what this looks like. All right, so in this case, if I make this plot, this has to be a dot times for this to work. And I'll put a grid on here. Right, so this is the function. Again, I'm looking for, I moved everything to the left-hand side. I'm looking for where it crosses zero. Now, the plot doesn't help me out here, so something like ginput is not going to be very useful, because we see it starts as a very small number, and then as x or beta gets larger and larger and larger, this gets very, very large. So if I change the scale of this, if I only plot it to like 5, we see when we zoom in, when x is only 0 to 5, it clearly crosses 0 once and then twice. But when we're zoomed out, we can't see that happening. So if we solve this numerically, we're going to have a better idea of where these, we can find where all these zeros are going to occur. And again, I want to find the first 6 positive values. All right, so we see when we're zoomed in here, we're going to have one around 2, and then another one around 4.7. But there's going to be, we want the first 6 of them. So what we can use here is the f0 command. So I want to find the value of x that makes my expression y equal to 0. And then I have to put in my initial guess. Well, from the plotting, I can see that my first one should be around 2. Let's just see what happens if I make 0 my initial guess. I run just this line. It does come up with an answer, but it's negative. But if we look at the prompt, it wants the first 6 positive values. So even though this does satisfy that the equality is equal to 0, it's not the one that we want to start with. So I'll put another guess of 1 in. And we get here that we get a 0 at 1.87. Again, looking at our figure, this looks about right. That's where that first 0 crossing is. So I want to save this. I'm going to save this in a vector that I'm going to call b. So what I'm doing here is I'm going to fill in the values of b, where each value in b corresponds to the first, second, third, fourth, etc., 0 of my function. So if I run this, I've saved to the first element in b the value, the first 0 that I found, 1.8751. Now I want to save the second 0 of my function. So same thing again, but I have a different start point this time. Now again, from plotting it, I know that my second 0 should be about 4.7. So I'm going to put in a guess here of 4.5 and see what I get. All right, so I got about 4.7, which by eyeball was pretty close, and I filled in the second value of b, or the second 0 in my function. All right, so I have 2 of the 6 down. But if I look, I need to kind of zoom out my plot a little bit more. So I need to extend this. So I'm going to apply it not only to 5, but to 10. And now here, it's really tough to tell where my zeros are happening because the function gets so large. So something, again, by eye, like with ginput, is not going to help me too much. But we see if we come down here, we should have another 0 around 7.7. So my third value, I'm going to guess, is around 7.5. And I'll run this to see if I'm there. All right, so around 7.9 is where I have that third 0. Again, on this plot, I can't see any more zeros, but I need 3 more zeros. So I'm going to zoom out kind of all the way to 25 here. All right, so I have to now kind of keep going, but I won't have a visual way to look at it. So I'm going to make another guess that I have a 0 at near 11. We see actually that guess was pretty close. The fourth 0, presumably the fourth 0 is near 11. Now I don't necessarily know that there's not another 0 between 7.8 and 10, about 11, but I can kind of keep testing it out by having guesses that are fairly close to my previous guess. So you see if my guess is 8, I repeat that third 0 again, so that's not an answer. Again, with 9, I repeat that same 0. At 10, I get presumably my next 0. Again, we don't have a guarantee there's not a 0 between those two, but if we kind of take small increments in our guess, then we're more likely to be getting the next 0 and not miss one. So we presume these are the first 5 zeros. Sorry, the first 4 zeros. We'll go for the fifth 0 now. I'll guess around 12. And we get the same 0 again. Now I found the presumably fifth 0 at 14.1. And we need one more. I'll make my guess 18 here. And we see that we find another unique 0. But again, just for due diligence, let me kind of sneak up on it. So with a guess of 16, I get that sixth unique 0. All right, so let's kind of recap what we've done so far. Let me rerun this entire cell. Right, so we have a plot. By eye, we have no idea where these zeros are actually hiding here. But we know that if I just type B and see all the zeros I've collected, I found my sixth 0 to be around 17. So let me zoom in my plot a little bit here. Just go up to 18 and replot it. Okay, so there's 6 zeros between 0 and, or at least 6 zeros between 0 and 17 here. So what I can do now is I can add on to my plot, as I've done before, the locations of these zeros, just so I can see graphically where they're going to lie. So I'm going to use that scatter command again. My x values are the location of my zeros. Again, b is now a vector. I've made it a 6-element vector by filling it in one at a time. And then I know my y values, because they're zeros of the function, are all going to be equal to 0. So what I can do here, I'm going to use the zeros function. So what the zeros function does is it makes a vector of zeros. And then the arguments you give it are how many columns of zeros to make, how many rows of zeros to make, and then how many columns to make. So if I just run this piece here, I see that I've made a column of 6 zeros, or I could make 1, 6, and I can make a row of 6 zeros. So with this command, let me make it fairly large here, I'm going to plot these 6 points and place it on top of my graph that I've already made. And I'll make this cyan, and I will make it stars, which is going to be P. And then go back to the plot so that there's a little bit more contrast there, and redo this. All right, so what I have is the plot of this, which it's very tough to tell where those zeros were, at least where the first 5 were, but I've plotted the location of those zeros, and then we can more clearly see where that 6th zero is. And most importantly, again, I have collected in B what all those zero values were. I'll fill in my plot a little bit more just to make it clearer what's happening here. So again, my horizontal axis represented my values of beta, and here I can use in my labels, it can handle some Greek symbols if I precede it with this forward slash and then the name of it. So this will put a beta as my x-axis, and then my y label, this is the function, I'll just call it y for now, and replot this. So now graphically, these are the zeros of my function. And lastly, I want to reiterate, how did I make this function that I'm finding the zeros of? My original equality, I had cosine beta L times cosh beta L equals -1. The f0 function only sees when an expression is equal to 0. So I had to take my original expression and I moved the -1 to the left-hand side, and that's why there's a +1 over here. So if we rewrite our equation, we have cosine times cosh +1 is equal to 0. And I'm finding what are the values of beta that make that true. I'm finding the first 6 values that make that true in this case.